apologies for absence?
No apologies for absence.
Got any declarations of interest?
No.
Can we agree the minutes of the last meeting? Prior to agreeing the minutes of the last meeting, there is a point, I think it's just the typing at the bottom of page one, appointment of deputy chair. Second to last paragraph, and Ian and Killen will be appointed chair for the ensuing year. Pretty sure that two chairs are to be as deputy chair. Can we agree those minutes?
Yeah.
Thank you. Let's move on to item number four, Liverpool City Region Combined Authority of Risk Management. It's a presentation by John Foxy. Thank you, John.
Thank you, Chair. Thanks. What the presentation's about really is the combined authority. It's part of this sort of suite of corporate governance documents, corporate governance arrangements, requires risk management, a risk register, just as your own district does, as other organisations do. Management of risk is obviously critical. And as the scale and complexity of the combined authority grows, its risk arrangements and its risk management arrangements need to grow correspondingly. The Audit and Governance Committee obviously play a very, very key part of that, is front and centre in the remit of this committee. As you'll be aware, the CA inherited the risk register from the ITA that was previously agreed by Merseyside Integrated Transport Authority, and also that of Halton for those transport functions. And in its first year, that was okay because it was only delivering any activities directly around transport and through Merseytravel and clearly also through Halton. So the CA and this committee agreed that we'd adopt the risk management arrangements in Merseytravel and Halton in respect of the CA's arrangements. But clearly now as the CA is growing, due to local growth fund and also increasing in its activities beyond just transport into employment and skills, and you know, in future with growth fund activities into housing and regeneration. The risk register really needs to grow and needs to be appropriate to that. So the risk management arrangements need to evolve, and in January, and it's really part of the suite of documents for next year, we'll be hoping to bring to this committee a risk register that corresponds to the current and next year's activities of the combined authority. So this presentation really is just to prompt some thoughts around what you might wish to be reflected in it, on what I think needs to be considered in pulling such a document together. So obviously organisations need to manage risk, and organisational failures happen when organisations don't manage the right risks or don't understand the risk environment. And there's some quite timely ones at the moment. There's the awful incident that Thomas Cook were involved in that was reported on yesterday, but clearly Thomas Cook felt that managing the risks around, you know, not being found liable for those two poor boys was a greater risk than actually not behaving properly, facing up to their responsibilities, and that's caused them a huge problem reputationally, you know, and quite rightly. But then they also look at, you know, the data breach with the mobile phone companies. The CEO of that company was on the radio and clearly didn't really get the issues around encryption and data security. That's caused a big fall in their share price. And Volkswagen, who clearly thought that cheating emissions tests was fine because there was a greater commercial risk from not doing so. Similar examples are everywhere, from banking collapses to military failures to all sorts. But they also occur in a smaller level within organisations where you perhaps took your eye off the ball, you're not managing the right risks, you're managing cash flow week to week and you fail to understand that there's bigger changes. And from a transport perspective and a CA in economic development, it's around making sure that, that our interventions are based on the right risk, if you like. And the right risk in terms of the combined authority is its function is principally around economic growth. So it's making sure our interventions promote economic growth or don't, or maximise the potential for economic growth. So we need to understand the environment at a very high level. We need to make sure that, in a transport perspective, we need to be based on current travel patterns, where people live, where people work, where people will live and work in the future, and how people will live and work in the future, because that's how we, you know, get most bangs for our bucks. There's risks around that, quite high and strategic, and I think that that's principally where the CA's risk register might like to focus. Again, the CA in, we're being prompted in that principally by Local Growth Fund and the fact that Local Growth Fund is millions and millions and millions of pounds. It isn't just being discharged by Merseytravel, Merseytravel is the accountable body, it's being discharged by all the partners, and it's got some really key involvements from third parties as well involved in that. But then, beyond Growth Fund, there are other areas of finance that are now coming in, or other areas of activity that are following the finances that are coming into the combined authority. Just say a little bit about transport risk, because although I've said that it's not just about transport, Merseytravel principally and also Halton are hugely important as direct delivery partners in the for the combined authority. Merseytravel itself has a really comprehensive risk register that reflects its activities and functions, and it's principally around keeping people moving and keeping people safe. So Merseytravel has some really big, fearsome risks that it needs to be involved in managing. So obviously if you run ferries on a river with landing stages and all of that, that, there's a huge responsibility, there's a huge regulatory environment in keeping that safe. It has big implications on our capital programme, on our ways of working. But then Merseytravel again is responsible for the Mersey Rail network, keeping that moving. We do it through a contractor. Well, that contractor has got, is very, very strictly regulated, as you'd expect. Running a railway is inherently very risky. So Merseytravel has that comprehensive risk register. You'll need to be assured that that is, you know, that is sufficient. But I would suggest that the risks that the CA need to be involved in understanding around transport are at a higher level around, as I said, getting people to work and etc. Making sure that the services remain contemporary. So it's about the bus and the rail network, which is Merseytravel and Halton, but it's also about the road network, which is not a traditional Merseytravel activity. So it's around us, you know, the condition of the roads, the strategic highways. It's also about the port, and it's also about freight and logistics. It's also about the airport. It's about the whole range of transport activity, road, rail, etc., not just around the traditional, if you like, public transport elements. One area, though, where combined authority does need to be aware of risk for directly managed services, the tunnels, because the combined authority clearly is the owner of those assets and has big asset management responsibilities. They're owned by the CA and managed through Merseytravel. I think the CA Audit Governance Committee needs to understand the risks around the tunnels. So there's economic risk to the economy of them providing, you know, through flow of traffic. There's congestion risks. But the main ones are around the safety of people using them and the sustainability of the tunnels. And that's really expensive. So one of the risks is to ensure that the tunnels have sufficient resources to operate now and in the future. Health and safety is paramount, and the tunnels have a very, very large capital programme every year in recognition of just the scale of operating them. The other risks then that are moving away from transport are around the growth fund. So clearly there's a very big multi-year, multi-million pound growth fund that the combined authority is responsible for. I've I've put the schemes up there, which you'll be familiar with. Some of them are, KIP is known as the industrial park. Mutual Loads Interchange, there are some other mechanisms, the SJBs, the Silver Jubilee Bridge in Alton. Big schemes, big major schemes. And some of those schemes as well are not reflecting their around employment and skills. And you know, those are risks that equally need to be managed. If we don't spend this money in the year, we effectively lose it. So we need to have systems in place to manage the delivery of those schemes, to be able to, where necessary, move resources from one scheme to another, reprofile quite nimbly, because the risks of losing it are, you know, are very, very high. So we need good information, good relationships with our delivery partners, and we, as I said, we need to be able to be in a position to have pipeline developments that we can bring on stream quickly. If other schemes are dragging, and there are risks around other schemes dragging, because we're very dependent on third parties in a number of areas, particularly network rail. And those will be reflecting the regular monitoring that the CA gets on that. Employment and skills is less money, but it's still big money, and it still has a big impact. And the delivery partners there are colleges and smaller organisations where we perhaps don't have the existing arrangements that we have and the existing relationships with. And often some of those delivery partners don't have the capacity to deliver that clearly district partners do. So again, it's something that we need to be aware of. And then there are other organisational risks that are probably generic to all organisations, but it is the risk of financial standing of the CA. CA has significant resources, we also have significant commitments, particularly in terms of tunnel tolls, but it brings in to play the infrastructure fund that's available for, you know, interventions and investment in infrastructure across the region, and also the reserve strategy of the combined authority. Combined authority has very significant reserves at present, some of which, around 50 to 60 million, are around the rolling stock that was inherited from the ITA. But there are other significant reserves as well as that, and you'll need to be happy that that reserve strategy is appropriate. That brings into play the financial standing of each of the districts that are contributing to the combined authority, and through the transport levy. And we know that we don't exist in isolation from financial issues that are being addressed by districts. We do set our budget responsibly and in a way that is done with consultation with yourselves. Having big reserves means we've got big issues of treasury management. Need to be aware that there's treasury management policy for the CA and whether you're happy with that treasury management policy. And then there's Merseytravel in particular, also Halton as key delivery partners in transport. The financial and performance risks around Merseytravel, financial risks around Merseytravel in particular, that's less so with Halton, different funding mechanisms. But Merseytravel overspends will have potentially an impact on the combined authority through that, the levy, if they're not managed properly. And then there's legal risks, and there's risk around ethical standards and fraud and corruption that you'd expect of all organisations. Devolution, again, is a little early to talk in any detail around devolution, but clearly with devolution there'll be new powers and budget, and there'll be new risks as well under a reformed governance model, potentially. And that just increases the pressures on financial and operational governance and the scrutiny functions. And it may impact on the authority being able to deliver its objectives potentially. So the governance model will be key. And hopefully by January there'll be more clarity on that. But again, it's just something that the risk register will need to pick up and be aware of. That's all I intended to say on it. Questions, and that's really the areas that I think will be reflected in kind of bespoke Liverpool City Region risk register. It's not just Merseytravel. Anything anybody wants to?
Yes, thanks, John. I think it makes commercial sense to have a risk register. I'm kind of disagree with that. The only thing that alerts me a little bit when I see network rail. Network rail is a loss themselves. I don't know how you mitigate that risk, because it's Norway and Norway sometimes. I mean, now surely that's our dealings with them has been caused us problems more than solved problems.
But we're doing quite a lot of work at the moment with Network Rail on a number of projects, Rolling Stock, Alton Curve, New Willows, Gold. And we're trying to, we've got a good relationship with them at a high level, and we need to translate that locally. There's been quite a lot of work being done in the last couple of months to having better contact regionally with Network Rail, and giving them some stake in what we're actually doing, so they've got some skin in the game as well. It's part of the devolution asset as well, Network Rail's involvement, but I agree, it is, they are a key delivery partner. In all of our major projects, we need to get governance arrangements that tie Network Rail into delivery. We feel that we've got a good relationship on the rolling stock infrastructure, and we're trying to translate that into the other projects, because, as I say, it's our risk, it's their delivery, we need to pass some of that risk through to them. Resources in a coherent way, so that, for example, the huge amount of money that we spend on transport services to levy is done in such a way that mirrors or matches housing and also clearly employment and skills are part of the housing, transport, regeneration. So it's all part of a coherent whole. Specifically on employment and skills, the growth fund interventions are based around employment and skills board, which is criteria for investment that's very much linked to those type of activities in those type of areas that get the most out of future industries, the future interventions, the future of employment in the city region. So it's making sure, as I say, that it's spent in a way that addresses future need and not traditional past delivery, if that makes sense.
Any further questions? Comments? I've got a comment, John. In relation to devolution, I think it'd be remiss if the combined authority or the committee not to assess the risks of not moving forward with the devolution. What would this region be held back on? Are there any red lines that we wouldn't cross to say wouldn't suit this region, both the leaders and obviously the residents of this region? And what are we likely to lose if we don't move forward? If other city regions obviously take their roles and some have in the recent past. Has been held back, at what point do we say, you know, well, we're actually losing this cost and this report by not being devolved?
Well, I think that's pretty much the crux of the decision that the CA will take on it, isn't it? Based on the risk, I think it's for the committee to determine whether it's as, you know, making that decision and making that determination is had all the information to hand around the risks of moving forward in the way that, that determines that it moves forward. But yeah, it's principally about risk and opportunity, isn't it?
There's no further questions or comments. Thanks very much, Rob. Appreciate that. We move on to item number 5 on the agenda. Liverpool City Region Combined Authority Audit Committee quarterly updates. That's Stephanie Collins.
Thank you, Chair. Just before I start, can I just apologise? There is a typing error on page 8, paragraph 3.7. There's two references there to paragraph 3.6 and 3.7. I'm not sure if you read 3.4 and 3.5 respectively. Apologies for that. So the purpose of this report then, which is attached to page 7, is to provide you with an update in respect of the internal audit work that's been undertaken on behalf of the Combined Authority during the second quarter of the year, that being July to September. And members will recall that there's an allocation of 150 audit days in Merseytravel's internal audit plan for us to undertake Combined Authority work. And you'll be aware that the majority of this work is around the form of brochures. You'll notice paragraph 3.7 that actually only 18 days have been utilised for this quarter. That brings the total year to date to just 32 days. The reason for this is because delivery by our partners for the various CA grant funded schemes is really only just beginning to gather pace. So therefore we have actually received very few claims thus far. However, the current situation is already in quarter three that we've received a significant increase in that. There's a lot of grant claim work ongoing at the moment, and that's going to continue to increase. So members are going to see a significant increase in output at the next and subsequent meetings of this committee. That's exactly what we expected, and that's exactly what we planned for, so that's not a concern. In terms of non-grant work, you'll note at paragraph 3.3 that we have proposed to carry out 4 non-grant assurance work reviews. We want to spread those out across the year. At the time that I wrote this report, a review of members' code of conduct was ongoing. As we stand right now, that's just been finalised, the draft report is just being produced. So we'll be reporting on the outcomes of that review at the next committee meeting. We've now just commenced a review of fast tag accounts management as well, and that falls under tunnels, tolls, recording systems and income. So that's also now ongoing. Members will also note at paragraph 3.8 that as the lead authority for employment and skills, Knowsley Council, internal audit section, have undertaken a governance review around the bidding process for the Skills Capital Investment Fund. We're informed by their head internal audit that substantial assurance was obtained and that the internal control environment around those arrangements were found to be operating effectively. In fact, just 2 recommendations were made. They've been accepted by managers and the details are there for you to see at 3.9. Going forward, though, that grant assurance work now is transferred to us for Skills and Capital Investment Fund. So that means that Merseytravel's internal audit section will be doing the grant assurance work around that fund, given that those funds have been administered by us now as the designated accountable body. In fact, we've received the first claims from the colleges that John just referred to before, and we're already starting to approve the first of those payments. So that's ongoing now as it stands in quarter three. And that's really concludes it. I'd be happy to take questions, Chair. Thank you.
Thank you, Stephanie. Any questions in relation to this report? Comments? So, if you'd like to accept the recommendation, paragraph 2. To note, you're going to take on board the Combined Authority during the second quarter and request further updates in respect of the internal audit work undertaken in accordance with the proposed plan of work during the year. Accepted? On to item number 6, Liverpool City Region Provider Authority Final Accounts 2014-15, and it's Dave Edge.
Thank you, Chair. This report really just summarises what's happened during the audit of the accounts for 2014-15. Back in July, the committee looked at the final accounts pre-audit. What we have then is a series of work that's taken out on your behalf by KPMG, which looks at the accounts their reports on their findings on the accounts throughout the year. There's two reports that you do. One's called an ISA 260, which is attached to Appendix A, which details all their findings and recommendations they've got. And after that, they also do an audit letter, which sort of summarises all of those issues. And again, that's attached to Appendix B for information. The only thing I wanted to raise really is the fact that there was some additional pieces of work that needs to be carried out this year, which has basically led to an increase in the audit fees. They're all listed in the report. In total, there's about an additional £10,000 that will be needed to be paid. CM reserves that are unable to do that without any sort of real consequences to it. Really, it's just a question if there are any questions. I'll see if I can answer them or not. Also,
thank you, Zane. Is there any questions in relation to this report? In relation to the previous audit committee for Merseytravel, as opposed to the combined authority, Merseytravel, I believe now is in the process of setting up an audit board, which consists of four members.
Four members, two directors and two lay members.
From KPMG's point of view, is that satisfactory to for that authority to actually move in that direction? Is that the right thing to do?
Yeah, I think it's very much the right thing to do. Audit committees are common, it's not committees, particularly in other public sector bodies, having non-executive directors on those audit committees gives the committee the opportunity to challenge the auditors in a lot more detail. Typically, you would get the sort of mix that you're proposing, which is executives, non-executives, and the non-executives generally get drawn from their areas of expertise. So risk, for example, governance, audit, internal audit, external audit. So that gives the opportunity to put this external knowledge in, basically to ensure that the regulatory side of the organisation is as good as it can be, and basically that's what it takes. The officers are given a hard time, so yes, it is the right thing to
do. As far as we're aware, correct me if I'm wrong on this one, the board meetings of that committee will document, unless commercially sensitive or restricted, will be made public anyway. So they've got public access for those audit meetings.
Yeah, that's the case, as you said. Less than less the same way that there's exclusions, but yes.
Thank you. In relation to the additional costs, I think there's an objection to the accounts, which are delayed, the accounts being finalised. How's that work going? Is that what's your work in progress, and is the time scale on
that? Yeah, we were unable to certify the position of the audit because of the objection. There are a few of our opinion on the accounts because the amount of being objected to the bill are the lack of materiality. So that's good news in that aspect. So we have received an objection, which we need to go through and give it due consideration. That work is substantially underway now, and I'm hoping to finish a bit of work on that during the course of this week. So the expectation is that we'll be able to complete our report back to you by the end of the month. All I need to just make sure is what involvement will be for the successful audit accreditation, the SAA. I'm not quite sure whether the reports need to be processed through them, but effectively we are very close to finishing the work now.
Thank you. Thanks very much. If there's no further questions from the committee, can I move the recommendations in paragraph 2 of the report? Agree. Thank you very much. Thank you very much.